questions before we get going. It's our last topic, and then we have our exam on Tuesday, 8 o'clock in here. Okay. Tomorrow, Friday afternoon at 2, I'll be in here for any of you that want to come and ask me questions. I have no lecture material, I have no agenda, I have no presentation for you. I'm just going to answer questions and cover material that you want further explanation about. And it'll be as long as you want to make it for whoever wants to come. Yes, Nicole?
The TA office hours on Sunday, is that just for lab or is that for...
No, she can answer questions as well, to the extent she can. I mean, it's not like I'm training her to be a biological psychology professor, but yes. All right. And I'll be here Monday as well if you guys have questions and want to make an appointment or stop in my office or email me. All that's fine. Okay? Just want to make sure that you learn the material and that you do well. All right. Good deal. So today, we're going to talk about plasticity in the brain. What is plasticity?
The ability to change.
The ability to change, right? We're not talking about putting plastic in your brain. Right? But plasticity is the ability of the brain to change. And, you know, we've talked about central nervous system neurons, when they die, can't be replaced, right? And that's true. But it doesn't mean that changes in our brain don't occur, and that we can't have pretty significant rewiring and changing of functions in the brain depending on experience. What drives plasticity? Experience. Okay? So this is an experiment they did with owl monkeys, and owl monkeys have 5 digits, and they mapped the representation of those 5 digits in the somatosensory cortex on the homunculus. So they're able to go in and electrically see, when I stimulate this finger, this part of the brain is active. And then when I switch over and stimulate the index finger, this part of the brain is active. And they map that out, and they know that these areas are not active, and which areas are active, right? Then they give them a task that causes them to have to use these 2 fingers a whole lot, and they have to discriminate different textures, and they get rewarded. Monkeys love fruit juice, so every time they get the task right, they get some fruit juice, and practice. And then they go back in and remap the monkey's brain. And after all this practice, all this stimulation, months of practice, this is what the map looks like. So what happened from before to after? The areas that got stimulated took over more cortex. They gained area in the brain. This is plasticity. So what about humans? Can this happen in humans? So here we see a professional keyboard player versus amateur players looking at places in their brain that are activated when they're playing the keyboard. And the professional players had more areas. These areas that are red and yellow are areas that were more activated in their brain than in the amateur players. So becoming a professional keyboard player, the amount of practice and experience that it takes to go from one level to the next, results in changes in our brain that make some areas more active than other people. And so here we see that mapped out, and we see the change here in particularly their hands gaining more surface area. And it wasn't just more surface area across, but it also spread out. Right? Now here's the thing. When we have plasticity in the brain, and now these areas are more active and take over new functions, or the fingers start using up more cortex, they're taking cortex away from something else.
we have limited resources. So it's not like there was this blank cortex next to them and they could just expand. So whatever was next to them got smaller. So it's a give and take relationship. It's a give and take relationship because we have finite resources. And remember, we're using 100% of our brain, not 10% of our brain. It's not like there's 90% of our brain that's in there available for us. All right. So, not just practice and experience can change the brain, but deprivation or loss can also change the brain. So in this case, we're talking about lack of use. So here we measure these fingers in the brain, the digits, their representation, just like we did before, and then we amputate one of the fingers. So we lose the ability to stimulate this part of the brain. That part of the brain doesn't die. It doesn't become rotten or quit being used. What happens when we go back in and remap this after some period of time to allow plasticity, what we find out is that the areas that are adjacent to the area that lost its input have taken over that level of cortex, that amount of cortex. So these two fingers have now taken over that finger. Yes, Nathan?
Is that why people say that if you have weak eyesight, you have better hearing and stuff like that? Is that where that comes from?
Yeah, that's kind of where that comes from, right? And it's probably not so true in the case of people, like if you have weak eyesight, you have better hearing. But people that are born blind, right, their brain develops in a very different way to use the visual cortex in a different way, not for sight, for things like hearing and touch, where they have, again, bigger areas of brain for those systems, therefore they may have better capabilities than a sight person would. Right? So it's not like all this back part of the brain for vision is not working in someone who's born blind, but when they develop, when the brain develops, other functions get coded in that area. We'll talk a little bit about that. Alright, so, but this is the basis for the phenomenon of phantom limb pain. Anyone ever heard of phantom limb pain? Unfortunately, since we've been involved in the wars in the Middle East with all of the IED bombs, and we've had a lot of veterans come back amputated with missing arms or legs or various parts of the body. And this is a real problem and something that people have to be treated for. And what this is that when you lose your arm, you have all of this cortex devoted to your arm and hands. And the adjacent areas, just like on the monkey that we amputated his finger, start to come in and take over that, right? And so what's adjacent to your arm and hands? Well, your face is very adjacent to that, and some parts of your shoulder or wherever next to adjacent to where the amputation occurred come in. And when they're taking over that area, now when I touch, my face, it's stimulating the part of my brain that it was my hand. And the brain sees that activity and it interprets that activity as the hand that's no longer there is feeling, is being touched. This is where the phantom limb comes from. And that confuses the brain because the brain's like, but I don't have a hand anymore, but I'm feeling it because my face is being touched. And anytime our brain gets seriously confused or the wiring gets crossed up, it interprets that as pain. It activates the pain center because it wants to alert you that something's wrong. And that's the way our body alerts us that something's wrong, is by stimulating that pain system. So not only do they get this phantom limb sensation, but that sensation, until the brain can learn that it's not the hand, that it's actually this adjacent area that's come in, until the brain can learn that, to perceive it differently, sometimes they experience pain. And that will go away once, sorry, I had all these nice little graphics, right? So they lose that comes in, right? And so a lot of the treatments of this are perceptual awareness treatments to help these people brain's stimulated, it's no longer their arm, but it's actually their shoulder or their face. And once they can perceptually encode that, then the brain doesn't interpret it as pain anymore. Yes?
I have a question about the last one. So
mm-hmm. Yeah. So that is a distinct possibility. Yes. Because there's a period of high plasticity and development when our brain is learning these things, right? And it becomes very difficult in an adult brain that's now more crystallized. We can have small changes, but it's very hard to do massive changes. Damage, and we'll talk now a little bit about damage. So talk about plasticity, talk a little bit about damage. So in the peripheral nervous system, the glial cells are those Schwann cells. They form the individual sheaths around our neurons out in the peripheral of our body. And remember, what did we say about neurons that get damaged in the peripheral nervous system? They can regrow, right? Central nervous system, they're gone. Peripheral nervous system, they regrow. So we cut a nerve, you sever your arm, and we reattach it. Over a period of time, those nerves can regrow, and you can regain your motor and sensory function. Maybe not 100%, but maybe 100%. And part of that regrowth and retraining is going to be a lot of rehabilitation of using that limb, that arm, because without experience, we don't experience drives this plasticity and development. So once these nerves are cut, the damaged area dies, and actually a new growth cone, just like in development, forms and seeks out neurotrophic signals to go back and find the muscle fiber that motor neuron was supposed to target in the first place. So just like in development, in the peripheral nervous system, we can regenerate these axons and reconnect them. Then they become remyelinated. Often when they're remyelinated, the myelin's in like shorter segments for some reason, but it's still, the signal's plenty fast. It's a slow process. They only regrow about 1.5 millimeters a day. Very slow process. It can take a long time, but they can regrow. Yes, Justin?
Would scarring kind of stop growth?
Yes. So that's why you have to be very careful with things like scarring. And in the brain, we'll talk about how that plays a role in preventing regrowth in the brain. In the peripheral nervous system, macrophages come in and like clean up the area where the nerve's supposed to travel through. And because of the way Schwann cells operate with being like single wrapped around a sheath, when they die and go away, there's no remaining scar tissue, so to speak. So that facilitates regrowth in the peripheral nervous system. Good question. All right. In the central nervous system, right, same thing happens. But now we have oligodendrocytes, and this is kind of showing oligodendrocytes like they're single wrap. Remember, oligodendrocytes had a soma, and then they would come out and wrap around an axon here. I'm not doing this very well. And wrap around an axon here. So they were reaching out with lots of arms to hold things sort of in place in our brain and myelinate. So they're both structural and myelinating. So when we have stroke or damage or trauma and a neuron dies in the brain or chemical toxicity, the things that come in to clean up in the brain are different than in the peripheral body. And so we have specific glial cells like astrocytes that come in to clean things up, and then they stay there and they form scar tissue and actually become a physical barrier for regrowth in the central nervous system. Now, you may think, well, that's horrible.
But it also has a protective feature because whatever caused this death, right, we don't want it to spread to other parts of the brain. So part of the protective feature of astrocytes is it's like putting a fence up. So nothing can get out and damage the rest of the brain, but the fence also becomes a barrier for regrowth of neurons. Right. And we don't think the same neurotrophic support is happening in an adult brain that's happening in the peripheral body. So these astrocytes become a real problem. This is staining of astrocytes in the normal rat cortex. And then this is staining of astrocytes following injury to cortex. And you can see the physical barrier, how much denser they are, and how it creates almost like a fence-like structure that would prohibit things from regrowing or getting out. There's more of them and more processes and much more dense. So, for ever since we discovered that peripheral neurons regrow and central neurons don't, people have been asking why. Because that's a huge, important question to figure out. If we can figure that out, then maybe we can figure out a treatment to make neurons regrow in the central nervous system, which would be phenomenal and cure lots of problems, right? Particularly, when we talk about the central nervous system, what are we talking about? The brain and the spine. Particularly in spinal injury, because we look at the spine, and the spinal cord is just like a huge nerve, right? I mean, it's basically a wire, a huge cable connecting our brain with our body. And so a lot of research has been focused on, can we figure out what's going on in our arm and that allows regrowth and make that happen in our spine so that we can, after spinal injury, have regrowth of neurons. And one of the keys, clues, has been the fact that we have these different myelinating glial cells. So people for a long time thought it must be something about the Schwann cells that helps this process as opposed to the oculated dendrocytes. And so one of the things that researchers have done with some success experimentally in animals is to cut the spinal cord and then in between that cut create a bridge packed with Schwann cells, packed with the things that we think help neurons regenerate and regrow. And it turns out that when we do that and then 6 weeks later we inject a dye above the cut near the brainstem and neurons pick up that dye, we can actually see both some axons projecting down past the bridge into the other part of the spinal cord and some cell bodies, which means the neurons regrew up and took the dye up in their synapse and transmitted it back down. There's been some success with this. Now, it's a very small percent, like maybe less than 10% of the neurons do this, regrow through. So we haven't figured it all out, but we're gaining on it, right? We're figuring out processes that might help with this. And some of this has to do with maybe having the appropriate stimulation in addition to the right environment, having the right stimulation in order to cause this to happen. And there's a group down at the University of Miami that is specializing in all kinds of paralyzed spinal damage research, and they're the ones doing this. All right. Degeneration is when we have this loss of the neurons. And so there's some different types of degeneration. In the peripheral nervous system, when we cut the axon, we get what we call anterograde degeneration. We get loss of the neuron from wherever we cut to the synapse, right, to the peripheral connection towards the target. And so this most often happens in the peripheral nervous system and is successful in regrowth. This is the regeneration that we talked about. Now, and it's very problematic for this to happen because of the scar tissue and the environment in the central nervous system. The closer the cut is to the soma, the less likely we'll be able to do regeneration to the target. So where are the soma for your peripheral nervous system, for your sensory system?
Spinal cord.
Just outside the spinal cord in that dorsal root ganglion, right? So we want all the soma together, kind of out of the way, right up next to your spinal cord. So think about that. That's a great design, because if you're going to have injury, it's probably going to be peripheral in your arms or legs and further away from the spinal cord. If you have a cut right in your spinal cord, then that's when it's probably not going to regrow. Retrograde degeneration is where when you have the cut, it goes towards the soma, not towards the target. And that's the bad kind. So we kill the soma, we kill the neuron. And we can't replace those. Right? And so the soma, as we mentioned, for the somatic nervous system are located near the spinal cord, which helps prevent retrograde degeneration and helps promote anterograde degeneration. It can also have a thing called transneuronal degeneration, which tends to happen in the brain, which is where when we lose a neuron, then the neurons that it was then connected to also die. So we pass neurons that are connected to each other. And then we lose that middle one. So we have damage to this one, right? We get anterograde loss and retrograde loss. And that neuron goes away. And because this neuron lost its input, and because this neuron lost its output, right, they might be subject to also dying. And what happens if now this neuron dies? Right, so now we have this problem of this chain reaction. And we call that chain reaction a penumbra. And I'll talk about that when we talk about stroke in just a second. Alright. So, some types of brain damage. Being shot with a bullet is not good. It causes lots of brain damage, as you can see. So anytime we have trauma to the brain where something goes into the brain tissue, it's going to be really bad. Right? This is a stroke that was fatal. And here you can see that the white matter is all pushed into the lateral ventricles. It's a horizontal cut, right? So here's the lateral ventricles. And there's a lot of malformation from the stroke there. This is a stroke that was survived. Well, until they died and took their brain out to look at what happened. But it was died of other causes. And this is the side of the brain that was affected by the stroke. So what do you notice about this side of the brain that's different from the normal side of the brain?
There's damaged areas on the other side. There's darker areas,
deeper. And what about the ventricle? Huh?
It's oddly shaped.
It's bigger, which means what? It took fluid to go over the space where there used to be neurons, right? So we've lost neurons here, right? So, quiz you guys, but this is the internal capsule. This is the caudate. This is the lentiform nucleus. These are the basic ganglia. Basic ganglia are involved with movement, with thinking, and so with regulating sort of thinking loops in our brain. And over here on the damaged side, where is the caudate? And the internal capsule. It's gone, and the lentiform nucleus is kind of misshapen. So there was damage here, but it was survivable. It wasn't so bad that it caused death.
person probably had movement disorders on the left side of their body, because this is the right side of the brain. Right. Yes?
You said the lateral ventricles were much more larger, and what did you say? They said something about the fluid?
So the fluid then, so when neurons die, this space gets bigger and gets filled in with CSF. So that's, I mean, it's not like the CSF caused it, but when, I mean, we just don't have the air in the brain, right? And so when neurons die and their spaces get larger, then it fills with this cerebral spinal fluid.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. So all of these were post-mortem taken out looking at the brain, right? So we've made a lot of advances with neuroimagery. We talked about PET scans and MRIs and fMRIs way back in the first day of class. But it's still very difficult to see, unless there's some real traumatic changes in the brain like this. We can go in and structurally see the ventricles bigger on one side than the other, right? But in things like Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, that are neurodegenerative, we can't see the plaques. We can't see the loss of the dopamine neurons with our neuroimaging. We can see it once they die, and we do histology and section the brain, and then we can visualize it. But right now, we can't do that. And so that's a problem with diagnosing, because we don't have a way to diagnose those things very well without just looking at behavior. Right? Yes, Katie?
So since all of that area, like on the left side of the same, which is supposed to be like neurons and whatnot going in there, when they start to die, does it make just a hole, or does that get taken over by tissues on the dead tissue?
There can be some what we would call infarcts, which would be dead tissue. But these neurons, they were on the peripheral of the lateral ventricle. The lateral ventricle just took over that space, right? Because it was next to it. All right.
Types of brain damage.
Y'all find this interesting, fun? No? Yes? I mean, we're not talking about chemicals and electrical signaling. Okay. So the number one cause of brain damage is trauma. Number one cause. A lot of attention to trauma with closed head injury, with concussions in sports in the last couple of years. But anytime that we have closed head trauma, trauma to the brain can only sustain so much force before it gets smushed up against the skull. There's only so much cushioning in the CSF around the brain. Strokes, next highest cause of brain damage. And strokes are really the lack of energy to the brain caused by not having blood flow to the brain. So when you have a heart attack, what kills you? Lack of oxygen. It's not the fact that your heart's not working anymore, it's the fact that your heart's not putting 15% of your cardiac output to your brain. And so you essentially have a stroke when you have a heart attack, because you're not getting a massive stroke, because the whole brain's not getting any energy, the heart's not working. Which is why CPR is so important, because immediately starting chest compressions, you're moving the blood that's still oxygenated through the brain, preventing brain damage. Very important. The sooner that happens, the better. So, two types of strokes, ischemic strokes and hemorrhages. Hemorrhages are bad. You're usually not survived unless you're very lucky. A hemorrhage is where we actually break the blood-brain barrier, we rupture an artery, and you lose your blood supply because you're bleeding in the brain. And blood is toxic to the brain because you get a blood-brain barrier, so that you can see why this is much worse than ischemic strokes, which is where we block or restrict blood flow to the area of the brain, and then just that area is sort of. Edema is the word we use when we talk about buildup of fluid. So if we have a hemorrhage, the blood that's coming into the brain is producing an edema. So in that stroke that you saw that was not survived and the brain was all smushed over into the ventricle, that's because of an edema, pushed all the tissue over there. Edema can also happen with trauma. So your brain is a lot like your muscles in the fact that if I come up and I really punch you in the arm, right, what's going to happen to that muscle? It's going to bruise. It's going to swell. It's going to become swollen and bruised. And that's what happens when you have head trauma. Your brain starts to swell. And it's in a skull. It's restricted on how much space it has. And so that's something that physicians and emergency room doctors are very concerned with close-in injury, is there any brain swell. In particular, we want to make sure the ventricles are blocked. So remember that CSF is always being made, gets turned over 3 times a day. So if it's not able to get out of the brain, it builds pressure up inside the brain. But what is the most narrow spot in the ventricle system? Think about your neuronal. I really made you learn that cheap brain stuff for a reason. This is why. The cerebral aqueduct, which is right in the brain stem, right underneath the cerebellum, like right at that sort of junction down here. So if there's a lot of pressure, it can cause that pipe to close. And when that pipe closes, none of the CSF can get out of the lateral ventricle or third ventricle. And so those lateral and third ventricles just keep pushing on the brain from inside, from the midbrain. And that, and often in that case, we have to go in and put a shunt in, put a physical tube in to drain off that pressure. Then we have toxins, including drugs, tumors, and neurodegenerative diseases after we have trauma and stroke. Neurodegenerative diseases, we'll talk about those today. It could be both infectious and genetic or unknown cause. And these include things like viral encephalitis, meningitis, Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, or mad cow disease, or prion disease, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and Huntington's are some big ones. And we're going to talk about Alzheimer's, we talk about memory in the brain, we talk about Parkinson's and Huntington's, we talk about the motor system next week, next Thursday and 1 week from now. But I'll talk about some of these other ones today. All right. Closed head trauma. This is an older statistic that may have gone up some now, but about over 500,000 ER visits for closed head trauma. And that's people that actually have closed head trauma and go to the hospital. There's a lot more people that have closed head trauma that don't, it's not severe enough to cause them to go to the hospital. Right. In people under 30 years of age, the most common reason is car accidents. Where they hit their head on the windshield or get ejected from the car, or have some other kind of trauma to their head. People over 65, most common reason is they fall. And they lose their balance and they fall and they hit their head on something and that causes a closed head trauma. But it doesn't take a whole lot of force. Just falling and hitting your head hard can cause brain injury, can cause a concussion. Those of you that are athletes or looked at sports, you know, you don't have to be hit too hard to have concussive types of symptoms. So what happens, we have this small amount of CSF providing cushioning, so when I go like this, I'm not causing brain damage, right? But if you hit your head hard enough, you exceed that force and the brain gets smushed into the skull, and then it bounces backward, and we have an injury in the back part of the brain as well. So we have what's called a coup, counter coup. We have like a primary area of damage, and then we can often have a secondary area of damage. The worst type of closed head trauma you can have is where there's rotational forces. Because when the brain's rotating and twisting, we're sort of shearing or twisting those long axons going through the corpus callosum, and that can damage those axons. And if we damage the corpus callosum, that produces all kinds of effects, right? We're limiting our brain's ability to communicate in a very serious way. And so, having recognized this, things like in NASCAR racing after Dale Earnhardt Sr. died, they came up with all kinds of new safety precautions, including this harness that the drivers wear on their shoulder that hooks to their helmet that keeps their helmet from producing too much force in a wreck, so their helmet can't go far past their shoulders. Your shoulders hold your head. And it also keeps the head from turning too much, so it limits rotational forces as well. Right? The NFL is now talking about trying to invest in position-specific helmets that have different types of cushioning for different ways different players get hit. So offensive linemen and wide receivers and running backs have different types of contact to their head, and they want to develop specialized protection to try to prevent concussions. The orbital frontal area here, which is involved with emotion regulation and social inhibition and personality, is highly susceptible to damage because there's a bone right here. And so it can rub into that bone and grate against that bone and cause damage. And a lot of the CTE, the concussion traumatic experience or something like that. But it's concussive syndrome is what it used to be called. A lot of those symptoms are changes in personality, changes in emotional regulation, thoughts of suicide. That's because of damage to these orbital frontal areas here. Another place is the front of the temporal lobe. There's a bone right here. And so that's another place that can get damaged. And what's the temporal lobe do? Because you have an exam in 5 days. Temporal lobe. Hearing and communication, and that's kind of back here, so it's not as affected. But what else is the temporal lobe doing? Stores. What's in the temporal lobe? The hippocampus, what's it do? Learning and memory. And memories are stored in the hippocampus. And so what's one of the symptoms of concussion syndrome? Memory problems, right? Because we've damaged parts of the temporal lobe. All right. So, this used to be called, a long time ago, not so long ago actually, dementia pugilistic. Now, this is what it's called, CTE. Chronic post-traumatic encephalopathy. I never heard of that. Right? CTE is now what it's called, or concussive syndrome sometimes. And this was first really identified in boxing because boxers are just getting continuously hit in the head over years and years and years. And they were developing, like Muhammad Ali has, these really severe types of frontal lobe problems and movement problems when it gets into mixed with gangrene. A 2-minute loss of consciousness, you get a concussion that results in someone losing consciousness for less than 2 minutes. You typically expect some acute memory loss, some acute effects for a couple of days, usually can be recovered from. May take a couple weeks, depending on the severity of it. When we have someone who loses consciousness for longer than 2 minutes because of a concussion, that's sort of a threshold where we start to see much more severe effects. So we see problems 2 weeks out, a year out, maybe never fully recover, sort of thing. So this, you know, is a very sensitive thing. If you get hit hard enough that you stay out longer than 2 minutes, that's going to cause some long-term problems, potentially. More likely, if you're like, wait a minute, I had a concussion, it was 4 minutes. But this does seem to be sort of a defining thing that minor concussions usually result in less than 2 minutes. All right, so here's what I was talking about with the rotational forces. So here, this is at the time of injury, a brain scan, and we see some swelling of the brain, so it's kind of closer to the skull than normal, especially back here, right? And here we see our cerebral aqueduct, and we want to make sure it's nice and open so that fluid can get through into the fourth ventricle. But at 2 weeks later, it's 2 weeks later, right? What do you notice the follow-up visit of the brain? What's different between those? This ventricle has gotten bigger because what's gotten smaller? Here's our nice healthy corpus callosum and fornix. And then over here, we get our corpus callosum. Right? And our fornix. So those are major long axonal pathways that with rotational force, as I mentioned, get twisted and injured, and so neurons die. And now we have a brain that's trying to communicate back and forth with all these areas and make everything work. And it's doing it with half the resources to be able to do that. And so that causes widespread problems. It causes problems with people being able to think clearly, being able to form memories, being able to perceive things clearly. All right. Really overwhelming today. All right, let's talk about stroke. So, ischemic stroke and hemorrhage stroke. In stroke, we decrease the blood flow to an area. If we decrease the blood flow, we're losing our nutrients. And what do we need those nutrients for? Why do we need them to live? What do they do? We don't need them to open voltage-gated channels and neurons, right? What do we need energy to do? The sodium-potassium pump, right, needs the energy. So if the sodium-potassium pump can't operate at 100%, then we're not able to restore those ion concentrations. And sodium and calcium build up inside the neuron. Because I didn't talk about this, but when calcium comes in for exocytosis, we also have to get that back out so it can come in again. So there's actually a calcium pump in the axon terminal that gets that out and brings it back in. So we get sodium and calcium building up inside the neuron, potassium building up outside the neuron, and that makes it harder for that neuron to send signals. It's making like the refractory period really long, right? So neurons die, and glial cells come in to clean up the waste. Now, what's one of the normal functions of glial cells? Talk about some things they do in the brain. They absorb neurotransmitters. It's one of the three ways that we get neurotransmitters out of the synapse. And in particular, they're really good at absorbing glutamate and getting glutamate out of the synapse. And what is glutamate? Primarily. What's its action primarily? Excitatory. So when these glial cells come in, they dump the neurotransmitter that they were absorbing, so they come in and clean up this dead neuron. And when they do that, that glutamate stimulates the cells around the damaged area. So now we have a system where we're stimulating the surrounding neurons who have less energy to handle that stimulation. All right? And if they can't handle that stimulation, then they end up in the same situation and they die. And more glial cells come in. And then they dump their neurotransmitter. And then the surrounding area. And so what we end up with is a primary site. Alright, so we have a primary site here. It's going to die because it doesn't have, we had a cholesterol plaque that came up in an artery and blocked it and didn't allow any blood there. And so it dies. But then this area dies. And when that area dies, they drop their neurotransmitter, and then this area dies. And then this area dies. And then this area dies. Right? And it expands. And this is called, as I mentioned, the penumbra. So we have a primary stroke damage area. And then we have a secondary area that's damaged because of this overstimulation of the brain. And in fact, you know, this is treatable. We're developing methods to prevent the spread of this, if people can get to the emergency room quick enough. So there's been, I'm sure you've seen the ads, a big push over the last couple of years with public service announcements and all this, that if you, you know, as soon as you detect a stroke, you gotta get to the hospital. Because the longer you wait to go to the hospital, the more damage happens. And so that's been a public service message that's been put out there by our
our health departments to try and increase awareness of this. All right, hemorrhage. Now we have blood, toxic neurons, so they're going to die, right? Edema forms, glial cells expand, they dump their neurotransmitter, right? We have decreased blood flow because the blood that's now going into the brain is not going where it was supposed to go to produce oxygen. So this is a really bad system, right? And so we have the same sort of thing, cycle that can happen with the penumbra, but now we've put toxic blood in the mix. And like I said, these are usually not survivable. When people have small hemorrhages and survive, it's because they're able to get to the hospital and stop the bleeding very quickly and limit the impact on the brain.
How quickly would that have to be,
treated?
Yeah.
Quickly.
I mean, like a few minutes or like...
No, but it depends on... So usually, hemorrhages kill people because they're big, and blood goes everywhere, and before they can get them to the hospital, they're already dead, right? If you have a hemorrhage and it's small, right, that's when it's survivable because they have enough time to get you to the hospital, figure out that you're hemorrhaging, get you into surgery, seal up the blood that's leaking out of there, that sort of thing. Finally, we can have drugs that overstimulate the brain in a way that cause those cells to exceed, even though we're not having a stroke, we can have drugs that artificially exceed the ability of the sodium potassium pump to keep up. And if they exceed that ability, it's what we call excitotoxicity. We're killing neurons because we're exciting them too much. And the same thing happens. And the same vicious cycle, then, can also happen where it can impact other neurons because of the dumping of the glutamate and the then spread of the penumbra from a primary site. So we can have this excitotoxicity, overstimulation of some drugs. Alright. Strokes cause primary damage, number causes. Secondary damage, overstimulation happens, shortage of the energy supply affects the potassium pumps, right? Sodium, potassium, calcium build up. What happens in apoptosis? We talked about the steps of apoptosis, normal cell death. What happens when the cell doesn't hook up correctly? Anyone remember?
There's certain things that inhibit apoptosis.
Yeah, there's certain things that inhibit apoptosis, and this Diablo protein, right, comes in and causes the cell death. But what causes the Diablo protein to get released? Influx of calcium, too much calcium. So this too much calcium, calcium's a really important signal to our neurons. It's a signal to release neurotransmitters, but having too much calcium tells the neuron, hey, I'm broken, I should die, right? And to go through apoptosis. So calcium's a real important thing, right? And then we get proliferation of glial cells to try to prevent this, because astrocytes are coming in, creating scar tissue, right? So we have all this mess going on in our brain. All right, so how do we treat this? Yes, ma'am.
Can they remove scar tissue?
First, we want to eliminate the source of the damage. So particularly in ischemic stroke, we want to open up the artery again. So we're going to stick a catheter up and try and release the blockage. Or we're going to give you drugs. If it's a blood clot that's there, we're going to give you drugs that are going to cause the blood not to clot, right? So that clot will dissolve, essentially, right? Or you might have to have surgery to come in and eliminate the blockage. We're going to look at brain swelling and try and relieve pressure by putting a shunt in. Then we want to reduce the secondary effects of the penumbra. And this is where we've really been focusing a lot of energy, because there's only so much we can do for the primary damage, but if we can prevent the secondary damage, you'd much rather just have the orange spot than the red spot, right? So there's specific drugs we've been using for a long time
that try and prevent this. And so the thing about what we're trying to do is prevent excitotoxicity. So we want to put in glutamate antagonists, antagonistic drugs to block the glutamate's excitatory effect, or GABA agonists, which are inhibitory, which are going to act in opposition and cause IPSPs to prevent overstimulation, or calcium blockers, because calcium is that signal for apoptosis. And we've even looked at putting neurotrophins in to try and promote cell survival. Just try and say, hey, you're healthy, don't die. Right? This is some of the newest stuff that's come out. Is the fact that endocannabinoids, what we know about our natural neurotransmitters, anandamide and 2DG, anandamide and 2A2G. Those are chemicals that are naturally released in our brain, and they bind to CB1 and CB2 receptors, which are cannabinoid 1, cannabinoid 2 receptors. And so THC in marijuana, this is where it has its primary action. It's on this system. This system naturally in our brain is a retrograde system that sends a signal backwards to this neuron and says, hey, your stimulation was okay with me. I learned. I'm stronger. Don't send as much glutamate next time. You don't have to keep stimulating me because I got a stronger synapse and I learned. Okay? And so these naturally reduce glutamate release. And so here in these rat brains, what we see is on the left, both of these rats were subject to oxygen deprivation, like simulating a stroke. Okay? And 30 minutes after the stroke, this group received an injection of anandamide, and this is the control group. And what you see is that the there was less brain injury here than here. Right? And this is in your book too. I went and actually looked up an actual article to read about it, but because this is new stuff. This PEA acts to facilitate the natural release of anandamide 2DG, and that's what was over here. And so here we see that it also caused less injury on this side. So here you can really see it. Here, they're saying there's less injury, but like here, this looks like more injury. The red represents healthy tissue, the white represents not healthy tissue. Here you can see them quantifying it and showing that in the cortex there was more difference there. Not as much in the subcortex, and we don't find CB1 receptors or CB2 receptors in subcortical areas. They're found primarily in the cortex for this effect of learning and memory. So selective for the cortex, and it helped reduce brain injury. And in fact, just last week, forget which NFL player it was, but he was lobbying to allow NFL players to use marijuana as a neuroprotective measure against concussions. Yes, did you have a question?
Yes, I was
PEA. PEA is another chemical that naturally enhances the brain's release of these. So they put the actual brain neurotransmitter in over here, and over here they use the chemical to sort of bump it up, if you will. Right? Alright. Okay. Another way to reduce the penumbra is to decrease the oxygen need. So remember when we talked about ischemia and lack of oxygen in the brain, and then how someone who falls into an icy lake and gets trapped under the ice, they may end up surviving even though they were under for 20 minutes. But you never hear that in warm water because it's the cold that reduces the need of the brain for that oxygen. And so now we've learned to use this as a therapy, and so they actually have on ambulances cooling rigs that when they find somebody that's had a stroke, they could start cooling their body temperature down on the way to the hospital. And they will often induce hypothermia for 2 to 3 days after the stroke to try and reduce the spread of the penumbra. And it's pretty effective. And there's a video on the Moodle site that you can watch. I recommend that you watch it. It's very short, a couple minutes, but talking about this. All right. So the whole point of all of this, right, is that we're reducing excitotoxicity or the need for energy. All right. Brain damage and recovery. We can have, when we lose a neuron, right, other neurons can come in and do what we call collateral sprouting. They can increase their connectedness to take up that slack, if you will. This only occurs, obviously, in a localized part of the brain. So we're not going to have a neuron over here collateral sprouting into this area, right? But when we have selected neural loss, we can sometimes compensate. What's going to cause this neuron to grow over here and have new dendrites? Experience and use. So rehabilitation, using the arm that was paralyzed in the stroke in rehabilitation, stimulates this brain plasticity and regrowth and collateral sprouting. Here, we can also increase the sensitivity of the postsynaptic neuron by putting more receptors there. So if this had 2 inputs and now it just has 1, well, if we double the number of receptors over here, then we can compensate for that lost input. And that's called denervation, losing the input, supersensitivity, right? And so here, in this brain, on the right side, we kill the dopamine neuron. I mean, on the left side, we kill the dopamine neuron. This is the basal ganglia that has dopamine coming into it. This is a normal side where we didn't kill the dopamine neurons. Normal dopamine receptor activity. Here, you see much more dopamine receptors have been expressed looking for that missing input to compensate for the lack of dopamine coming in. Right? So they've upregulated the receptors for the missing input to compensate. So our brain has lots of compensatory ways to deal with mild trauma. All right. There's also behavioral mechanisms. And so people can have what's called learned adjustments, where they learn how to do things differently in order to still be functional. You can also have, and through behavioral therapy, right, students are learning, patients are learning, relearning tasks that were impaired by brain injury, and so often they're able to retrain or train new other areas of the brain to do the task that the damaged part did. And we'll talk about this when we get to language. It's a really cool therapy for Broca's aphasia patients. So when the language producing area of the brain gets damaged on the left side of the brain in stroke, there's this new therapy, relatively new therapy, where it's called melodic intonation, and basically often these patients can still sing even though they can't speak, because music and singing is controlled more on the right side of the brain that's not injured. And so they learn to communicate by singing what they're trying to say, and through lots of therapy can learn to take the melody out so that they actually are able to talk again and then not sound like they're singing. It's a really cool therapy, but they're essentially, sometimes it takes years to learn to do this, but they're retraining a new part of the brain to do something that previously it wasn't doing. Right? So repeated use is what's going to help with that. The collateral sprouting and retraining in these other areas. Brain's a remarkable thing and has lots of redundant pathways and pathways that are not being used normally that we can induce use in through experience. Areas that are not normally being stimulated. All right. Oh, last thing about this. Age matters. So the younger you are with brain injury, the more dramatic the recovery is. The older you are, the harder it is for the brain to repair itself. So, okay. All right. We'll talk some more about that. All right. We got to get up, because I'm seeing, like, people are, even though... Thank you.
What are you
doing? Oh, no.
Do you know that that's 27 ingredients? Oh, no!
Alright. Alright. From cute kids to brain tumors. Alright, so. It's hard to transition there. Alright, so. Brain tumors is when we have cells that are reproducing in the brain inappropriately and creating this tumor. And they can either be malignant or benign. So when they're benign, which means not bad, right, they're encapsulated. And so they're growing and they're creating pressure in the brain on areas, but they're constrained within in a capsule, so they're not spreading everywhere. When they metastasize, when they're malignant or bad and they metastasize, is when they break and then they can spread and infiltrate other areas. And that's harder to treat because we can come in and kind of cut out a benign tumor and put chemotherapy in that area and try and kill the tumor cells because we know where they are, but here when they spread is when it becomes more problematic. The most common kind of brain tumor are glial cells, not neurons. And so we have lots of different types of brain tumors that are named based on the type of glial cell that's involved, like astrocytomas, glioblastomas, medulloblastomas. It depends on where in the brain and what glial cells are involved is how they get named. Right? Meningiomas the meninges of the brain is the covering of the brain that sort of separates the central nervous system from the rest of the body. And when we get a tumor there, it's then going to push down on part of the brain and cause problems with that until it's removed. Right. Treatment, surgical removal, then chemotherapy to kill the remaining cancerous or tumorous cells that were growing in there. And we've gotten much more refined in how we're able to do this type of chemotherapy now, and to the fact that there's now even genetic forms of chemotherapy based on your genome package, that certain drugs work better than other drugs, and so we've gotten highly refined on this. I mean, it's still not fun to go through, but it's a lot better than it used to be and a lot more successful. Epilepsy. Two types of epilepsy, partial, focal, versus generalized. Partial or focal has a source where it starts. So we get this inappropriate electrical activity firing, and then that electroactivity spreads throughout the brain. A general usually starts in some subcortical part like the thalamus or the basal ganglia that's highly connected to lots of parts of the brain. And so it sort of just takes over the whole brain at once, as opposed to this area which has to kind of spread across the brain. All right. Two parts of epileptic seizures. Tonic is the loss of consciousness. And sometimes with partial seizures, the person might just look like they're kind of dazed or sort of not there, or may even become sort of unconscious or not responsive for a period of time, but not actually have the seizing, the clonic behaviors. Or if it spreads to motor areas and excites motor areas of the brain, that's when you get the seizing behavior. Right? Because now it's affecting the motor system. It's stimulating our muscles to contract, essentially. Right? And so you can actually look at this brain activity and see that that overexcitement and the tonic and clonic phase look a little bit different on EEG recordings. Treatment. Drugs that block sodium flow across the membrane. What's that going to do? We block sodium flow. It's going to make it harder for that electrical activity to get out of control. Anything that's going to generally inhibit the brain is going to be a treatment for epilepsy. Produce that excitation. GABA agonists is another treatment. And in fact, a ketogenic diet, anyone know what a ketogenic diet is? This is where a diet that you have very, very, very little, if any, carbohydrates. It's almost all proteins and fats. And if you do that for long enough, your body runs out of glucose.
Because it primarily makes glucose from carbohydrates, starches, and sugars. So, but your body is able to create an energy source for neurons called ketones from fat and from protein. And so your brain essentially switches over from being a glucose user to a ketone user for energy, and that in some way prevents this electrical activity. And so several, this often works with young kids, one, because you can control their diet very easily, and you're not putting drugs in the brain to while they're developing, that sort of thing. So it's often a treatment, sometimes successful for kids. There have been reports of, again, people using cannabis oil and endocannabinoids to treat epilepsy. And it's the same idea that you're reducing glutamate release, so you're making it harder for the brain to get excited. It's that one, so like a strobe light, if your focal source is in the visual system, that intense stimulation may cause this pattern of electrical activity from the incoming sensory input that then sparks the focal area, right? So there can be triggers, but it's going to depend on where that focal area is. All right, infectious disease. We can have bacteria or viral infections that damage the neurons, so meningitis is a common one. Syphilis is a sexually transmitted disease that affects the frontal lobes in the final stage. And then viral encephalitis. And so years ago, we used to talk about the West Nile virus. Do y'all remember that? Long time ago, right? There was a call, the West Nile virus going to kill everybody. And then it did, right? But about 20% of the people that get West Nile get a fever, headache, vomit. Less than 1%, it results in swelling of the brain that produces these problems. Now, what's everybody talking about? Zika, right? Zika virus, right? And even within this 1% that swelling of the brain, there's still a 90% survival rate, so we can treat this problem. Now we have Zika, which doesn't appear to affect the adult brain, but developing brains, it causes neuronal loss and this microencephaly so that we get smaller than normal brains during critical periods of pregnancy development. All right, another one that you guys may not think about is Lyme disease. We're down here, right? So we have some deer, not as much as in these areas, but it's primarily transmitted by tick bites and from deer. Usually, again, the symptoms are mild, but you can, if it's not treated, it can spread from the peripheral nervous system into the central nervous system and cause problems. And you can treat it with antibiotics, you just have to get the treatment soon. AIDS-related dementia. So AIDS does not kill neurons, but what AIDS does is affects your immune system. And when it does that in the brain, it invades macrophages and glial cells and it breaks down the epithelial cells of the blood-brain barrier, and those things then result in neuronal loss and can result in what we call dementia. But now we actually have really good HIV treatments that prevent this from happening, and so people are able to survive a lot longer with HIV, with the antiretroviral types of medications that we now have. All right, and then finally, let me get through this. We have prion disease. This is scary stuff, right? So this is mad cow disease or Creutzfeldt-Jakob's disease. It's fatal. No treatment for it. 100% fatal, which is quite scary. We have these little, tiny little proteins in our brain called prions that we didn't even know existed until we discovered mad cow disease. And then we're like, oh, what are these things in our brain? What do they do? And we still don't really know what prions naturally do. We don't really know what they do. But in prion disease, this infectious prion, when it comes in contact with normal prion, it is like a virus in the fact that it changes them into infectious prion that then can infect other things and spreads just like a virus in our brain. And it causes neurons to die and creates holes in the brain. And the brain looks like a sponge. And that's why it ends up being fatal. The good news of this is that you can only get it by consuming infected prions. And this is the problem that we have with mad cow disease, is they are actually grinding up the central nervous system of cows and feeding it back to other cows as a source of protein, and that's how mad cow disease spread. Because they're actually taking infected cows and feeding them to other cows, right? So as long as you don't eat, if you eat steak of an infected cow, you're okay. Because that's muscle, and it goes to the central nervous system. But if you eat central nervous system of an infected cow, then you would die, right? Or if part of an infected central nervous system gets into ground beef or something like that, and that becomes a problem. That's how it's been transmitted from cows to humans. It can cross species very easily, which is also something that normally doesn't happen with these kinds of things. And it has been discovered in sheep milk, but not in cow milk, which is good because we tend to not drink sheep milk. So you can actually drink the milk of an infected cow, but if you don't know it's infected, like, you can drink it and it appears safe. So, all right, we did it. Give yourselves a hand. We're there. All right. Sam won. I'm so pumped. We'll get 23 A's.